After nearly a century of fixed-line telecommunications dominated by the incumbent state-owned operators, and two decades of mobile telecommunications which saw the emergence of global giants in markets that grew beyond all expectations, we are now in a period of significant change. Previously, telco operators were able to maintain ownership and control of all aspects related to their businesses. However, due to a variety of emerging factors, including increasing competition, market saturation, and technical and regulatory complexities, operator cash flows and margins are starting to come under pressure, resulting in an increased focus on core competencies. We are now witnessing a trend where specialist businesses are emerging in order to deal with increasingly thinner and thinner slices of the overall communications landscape. This process of thin slicing, where a series of interdependencies are created across the communications business environment, we call the communications ecosystem. During the evolution of this ecosystem, significant new investment opportunities for specialist players such as Convergence Partners emerge. The forces driving the development of this ecosystem include, firstly, increasing technological complexity, which is in turn driving the use of more specialist skills. Secondly, the need for operators to adopt a more customer-centric approach to both protect and grow their market share, which is requiring increased focus on the customer-facing elements of their businesses while outsourcing all other elements. Third, the need to extract greater cost savings in an increasingly competitive environment. And lastly, regulatory and environmental pressures which are driving trends such as infrastructure sharing. Let us now examine the critical elements of communications infrastructure in the existing African market, taking the country of Tanzania on the African East Coast as an example. Up until recently, the international bandwidth needs of Tanzania were served only by satellite, driving up costs and constraining bandwidth in the country. Undersea optical fiber recently arrived when the SECOM cable landed near Dar es Salaam in July of 2009, bringing much-needed new international bandwidth capacity for both data and voice services to the market at heavily reduced prices. From SECOM's landing station just north of Dar es Salaam, a series of microwave and terrestrial fiber links are bringing this international bandwidth into data centers or co-location facilities in the city for onward distribution to enterprises and retail users based in the city. In Dar es Salaam itself, microwave and fiber metro rings from the data centers connect a series of base stations to enable broadband access networks to provide high-capacity data links to end users, mostly for enterprise use. This high-speed, high-capacity wireless bandwidth is vital in African markets as a replacement for scarce fixed-line DSL, as the availability of fiber and even copper links is very poor. These networks will enable new emerging trends such as cloud computing to also develop in Africa. Fiber direct to the home remains very costly in this market, but possibilities for direct fiber deployments into housing estates and office parks is garnering some interest, and we will continue to track these developments closely. Similarly, GSM base stations connect into the exchanges and network operating centers of mobile operators and carry mobile voice traffic to and from users in the city and elsewhere. True connections back to the data center or points of presence, POPs in short, these GSM networks can also carry the internet and data traffic typically to retail users via their smartphones. Having witnessed the micro picture within a city environment, let's turn to the communications infrastructure required across the country. Fiber and microwave links are in a process of being built from Dar es Salaam to the country's other major cities, in this case Dodoma, the capital. These cities will then build out their own access networks to bring new voice and data services to local enterprises and residents. Value-added services such as virtual private networks and managed network services via MPLS platform will run over the intercity links to allow enterprises with a national footprint such as banks and government services to operate a full service-wide area network. For route redundancy purposes and to expand networks further across the entire country, a national broadband ring will ultimately be required. It is inevitable that certain links will not carry sufficient traffic to render a fiber connection fully commercial, and either wireless links will be required or satellite hops will continue to be used. To this point, we firmly believe that satellite communications will continue to be required, particularly in the African environment, not only for these links to outlying towns and regions, but also for cellular backhaul solutions, corporate VSAT networks, and as redundancy for fiber routes. In terms of regional connectivity, players such as Sicom already offer full backhaul solutions from Mombasa in Kenya, across Kenya via Nairobi into Kampala in Uganda, and onwards to Kigali in Rwanda. These links cross country borders via international gateways in the form of switching infrastructure, which is typically operated by incumbent telco operators. Much of the infrastructure that we have described not only provides classic telecommunication services, but can be used for the delivery of broadcast communications as well, with fiber and wireless broadband infrastructure used for the delivery of IPTV, DBVH, and radio streaming services, the mounting of antennas onto GSM base stations to deliver mobile television to handsets, and satellite capacity which can be deployed for direct-to-home satellite television and radio services. We believe there is room in this complex environment for specialist infrastructure owners to emerge. Parties who will own and or manage specific components of the communications value chain. Given the emerging ecosystem, it is not our intention as Convergence Partners to compete head-on with the incumbent operators. Rather, we are looking to build and manage new infrastructure to service their growing needs and to aggregate and manage existing network components to assist the incumbents to extract significant cost savings and synergies. In the next segment, we will overview examples of the types of projects that interest us at Convergence Partners. In many of these instances, we have already established a significant presence as a platform to continue building a resilient and broad portfolio. Based on projects that have already been rolled out in West Africa, there is significant scope for third-party managed services into the international gateway environment for both voice and data. Upgrading of technology, fraud and grey route management, and revenue maximization are some of the key features that are offered by an independent manager. And gateway license holders, who are typically the incumbent state-owned fixed-line operators, are increasingly turning to independent providers of these services to assist them. We have established a relationship with a key participant in this sector and are busy developing joint projects which we believe will generate bankable opportunities in the short term. These projects typically lead to other opportunities such as carrier services management, as well as deployment of technologies to enable regulators to more accurately measure the quality of service obligations of licensed operators. On the long-haul terrestrial fiber front, we are already working with a number of African governments to provide managed services for their existing infrastructure on the ground. In many instances, these routes need to be upgraded and improved to provide for the best practice SLAs and availability undertakings expected by the operators. In addition, there is a need to extend these networks to build further fiber routes to reach cities and towns that are still satellite dependent, as well as to create ring-type redundancy in the architecture of these fiber systems. This will naturally also lead to the deployment, ownership, and management of metro fiber rings as a component of the overall fiber network infrastructure. As already mentioned, it is not our intention to compete head-on with the incumbent operators. This is particularly true of the mobile operators in Africa, who are dominant participants in the communications industry with significant financial resources available to them. Rather, we are working together with mobile players on certain managed services and shared infrastructure models. One example of the type of activity we are working on is a model for independent ownership and management of GSM base stations. The shared infrastructure philosophy of this tower management approach also yields significant environmental benefits to a country. We are already invested in satellite infrastructure and will continue to assess this space for further investments. Work has commenced on the possible launch of the second craft in the New Dawn series into our orbital slot at 33 degrees east, so as to establish an African satellite neighborhood in that slot. This craft will service the growing needs of the mobile backhaul, VSAT services, and DTH broadcasting segments, and may also provide broadband services using the new KA and X-band. Companies in our portfolio are already involved in establishing data centers for their customers. We are now actively evolving this activity towards an independent data center ownership model and providing managed data center services to third parties. We will also continue with the process of building out further broadband wireless access networks to service the needs, in particular, of enterprise customers in the major cities and towns across Africa. We have established an important foothold in this arena with our investment in networks in both Tanzania and Mozambique, and are expanding the footprints of these networks as well as seeking out opportunities for investments into license holders elsewhere on the continent. Similarly, we are assisting SICOM to expand its network both through increased inland links to reach landlocked cities and countries, as well as through a potential construction of further undersea links to reach other territories and to ultimately achieve a redundant ring offering full IP-based services. In conclusion, we believe we have developed a very clear view of the communications infrastructure ecosystem in Africa and a strong understanding of how these business models are likely to evolve in the future. We have also developed a focused approach to where it makes most sense for us as an investor to participate in each segment of this ecosystem. From pure infrastructure ownership in certain instances, to the management of resources in others, and participation in building and deployment of infrastructure where it makes sense. This is a very exciting end of the market to be involved in. We believe there will be superior growth opportunities for many years to come.